So a few weeks ago at work, I was looking up the Thomas the Tank Engine intro online. It's a long story. For the uninitiated, my job is as a video editor, which means that I stare at this kind of screen for about 8 hours every day. But this isn't the only part of production. Before editing, this voiceover audio that you're listening to right now had to be recorded, and the footage you're watching had to be acquired from somewhere. But while the skeleton for a video like this can be constructed within the confines of a single room, original video requires a bit more effort to obtain.
If you go outside and film something without any real thought, you're gonna have bad footage. But if you go outside and plan out how each element of the clip will be captured, you'll have something far more usable.
Often, people unfamiliar with the world of video are quick to hand sloppy footage to an editor and tell them to make it look good. But if the video itself wasn't filmed well to begin with, then the best solution is to film the clip again, but better.
If you go outside and film something without any real thought, you're gonna have bad footage. But if you plan out how each element of the clip will be captured, you're gonna have something far more usable.
Ideally, the editor's job isn't actually to edit anything, but rather to assemble a video that was so well planned that the director already knew what the final edit would look like before the cameras even started rolling. In the real world, that doesn't usually happen. Plans change, people improvise, life moves on. But good editing can, at the very least, convince the audience of that initial vision well enough that the average viewer wouldn't be able to know how much effort was put in. Today, post-production can fix a lot, but in the age of Thomas and Friends, technology forced editors to more closely align with their ideal role. In 1984, digital video didn't exist yet, so problems needed to be accounted for and solved in the planning phase. The easiest way to mitigate these sorts of issues in a live-action setting was to control the shooting environment. To this day, many sitcoms are shot on indoor sets with extremely controlled lighting and sound stages, but this setup inherently limits the ability of characters to travel. A new location either calls for a new set or an off-site shoot with all of the unpredictability that brings with it, and each of those set pieces have to be accompanied by an increase in the budget. Children's programming often calls for all manner of interesting locations and set pieces in order to maintain the interest of an audience with an inherently shorter attention span. This is a key reason as to why so many kids' shows are animated. Not only do their distinct visual styles more easily captivate audiences, they also end up being less expensive than the cost of executing those same ideas in live action. The clear example of a live-action children's program to refer to would be Sesame Street, which built massive sets for its wide cast of puppet characters to explore. But these sets existed thanks to the incredible fundraising job the show's producers did before production. Sesame Street started with a budget of $8 million, which equates to over $50 million today when adjusted for inflation. Thomas, meanwhile, just barely had enough of a budget to sustain itself, being independently helmed by producer Britt Allcroft for its first 18 years in production. So why wasn't Thomas animated? Because that wasn't what Thomas was supposed to be. The show was conceived as an adaptation of the Railway series of books, and Allcroft wanted to stay as true to those stories as she possibly could. Instead of hiring a diverse voice cast to play the wide array of colorful characters, a single narrator was used to tell the entire story over voiceover, like a father reading one of the Railway books to his child.
So Thomas ran round to the front and back down on the coaches ready to start.
Instead of using puppets or live actors to bring life to the screen, radio-controlled trains were used as the main cast of the show, inanimate on their own, but brought to life through the narration. Instead of a wide array of unique and diverse locations, the show would be grounded in the countryside of British-inspired Sodor, built to scale with miniature buildings, trees, and shrubbery. And instead of having human characters to bring a relatable slant, all humans in the show were represented by unmoving wooden figures. All of these decisions at first may appear to come off as being for purely budgetary reasons. A modern perspective can easily draw comparisons between Thomas and the various niche cinematic endeavors of relatively obscure YouTube storytellers. It's not a stretch to assume that many of these creators developed this passion out of playing make-believe with their toys before acquiring their camera. Injecting imagination, wonder, and discovery into otherwise lifeless figures is a key part of childhood for many, and seeing adults do the same exact thing on the TV screen was a sight to behold. The reason Thomas was successful was because, instead of transplanting children into a world they can never truly visit, instead of doing something that children could never do, Thomas and Friends did something kids themselves could also do. It just did it better. The level of professionalism that went into Thomas's approach of playing with trains was unprecedented. The key place where this is most apparent is with the characters themselves. The trains of Thomas and Friends are far from toys. They're a work of engineering prowess, with interchangeable faceplates, controllable steam exhaust, and, perhaps most impressively, moving eyes, all controlled by a radio receiver. While there are no actors in Thomas, there are people meticulously controlling the action, essentially playing a similar role through how they control the trains on camera. In between shots, faceplates may need to be swapped, but in some cases the train needs to return to the exact location it was in before the swap, so that a change in expression feels more like a stop-motion styled animation, and less like the jump cut that it actually is. Any transition, jump cut or otherwise, needed to be considered during the shoot when taking on-set elements into account. Every single moving element on set had to be consistent between shots to ensure continuity. Lights and turntables may be simple enough to control, but elements like the train's steam exhaust are far less predictable. If a bit of steam came into the shot, it needed to come from a logical direction, and it certainly couldn't pop in and out of the frame. Another key consideration that needed to happen during filming was everything outside of the set. In a miniature world, regular objects like cameras are gargantuan, and everything accompanying them, from tripods to lights to the people controlling them, are even more so. To the point that early episodes often had unintentional equipment cameos. On top of that, the use of long periscope lenses close to the action meant that even if something didn't appear in the frame, it could very easily affect the frame. Even just millimeters of unintended camera movement caused by outside elements often could lead to shaky shots when filming tiny subjects. Being a director of such a production may seem intimidating now, but most of these problems can be solved in post-production. Cutting out a tripod from a shot is as easy as increasing a clip's scale. Continuity errors between jump cuts can be fixed with a simple image mask. Changing a faceplate often wouldn't even really be necessary in the world of multi-point motion tracking. And stabilization issues can be fixed through mostly automated software tools. These solutions have not only fundamentally changed the role of the editor, but also the roles of the director, camera operator, and so on, who all can increasingly rely on the software instead of making something look good in the moment. 35 years ago, not only did these tools not exist, but digital video itself didn't exist. In 1984, if directors had any hope of getting a television production of this scope finished within a reasonable time frame, they had no choice but to roll with the punches and pray to Big Brother that everything worked out. And they had to do that while also knowing that they couldn't lean on an editor to fix their poor cinematography. Thomas and Friends succeeded not because of its editing, but because of everything that took place before editing. Today, it's easy to forget a lot of the inconveniences of times past and point out flaws for the sake of pointing out flaws. It's easy to look at a show like Thomas and Friends and be baffled by the sheer lunacy and ridiculousness of it all. But it gains a whole new meaning to filmmakers when taking the actual process of making the show into account. Which is why it's such a shame that, when I looked up the Thomas the Tank Engine intro at work, this is what I found. Thomas and Friends still airs to this day, but is a shell of its former self. While Thomas was a fairly inexpensive production, it simply couldn't keep up with the increasing accessibility of video editing and animation software, and in 2009, it was deemed more financially viable to outsource the show's production and switch it to a CGI animated format, complete with a full voice cast,
"That's a funny funnel,"
a wide array of colorful locations, and that absolute travesty of an introductory theme song. In 1984, Avid Media Composer was 5 years away. In 2019, Blender can be downloaded for free. Times change.
Tank Engine. I'm here in this cleared out corner of a basement. It's definitely not a jail cell. Please help me. Thank you so much for watching. This is a lot of fun to make. It was fun. I mean, it wasn't fun clearing out this corner of this basement, but it was fun doing the whole thing that I haven't actually done yet, but I'm telling you it was fun because you're watching the video at the end. And that's kind of how this narrative thing works. But I have some videos I want to recommend to you that I've made. Last year I made a video about 8th grade. It's this movie by Bo Burnham that very much resonated with me emotionally. And I made a really cool video about it that I quite enjoy. It gets a little bit meta towards the end, but I like the ones that get a bit meta towards the end. So hope you enjoy that. I also made a video earlier this year about objectivity, looking at dictionary and definitions and all that kind of stuff as to why objectivity theoretically does not exist and people place too much weight and emphasis on theoretical objectivity. It's sort of a kind of a capstone of like my journalism degree from back in the day, because I made a lot of the similar arguments back in class when I was in college. But yeah, so thank you so much for watching. Please check those out if you're interested. You can also support me via Patreon. I made a coffee page as well. My Patreon is now per video, so you don't need to like pay me every month, because I don't put out a video every month, so it was kind of stupid to do it the other way before. So we have that going on. By no means necessary, but I figured I'd mention a little change situation. And I mean, I haven't made a video on a zero budget since like 2017. This time the budget went towards these lights that are lighting me right now. But I'm in jail cell. We said I was in a jail cell, right? So I'm gonna go, I'm gonna break out, I'm gonna be free, and see you next time. Do 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 do